I chat. If past five, I haven't taken one, you can raise up my voice. Okay. Time is a valuable resource that we always choose to trade off every day. Whether it be the choice to doom scroll on TikTok because I don't know why, or it is because you want to study harder and spend more time trying to become a doctor, these are all choices we make that come at the expense of our time today and come at the expense of whether or not we can live a longer life. We would suggest that allowing a lifespan trade is not that much different, for the simple fact that oftentimes the natural decision of trading off your time, trading off things that allow you to live longer, are things that people already do now and by extension principally should be allowed. What does this look like therefore? Broadly, we would say it would be facilitated by the government. So it would actually be a market such that you have things like it being taxed, it's ingrained into things like law, very similar to, for example, the fact that we have limitations on how are like the floors of people getting paid for in labor law, et cetera, et cetera. Why will this be regulated well? And we'd like to note four key reasons. One, it's because it affects large amounts of people who rely on it, whether it's people who rely on it as income or people who rely on it to find more and more time because they value time as a commodity. And that's not much different from many other markets that have these same incentives. But second, it is because in instances of failure, there's huge backlash. And oftentimes that failure can lead to things like tipping point into elections. So by design, governments are likely to do this well or has the incentive to do it even selfishly. But third, that we would likely have reasonable floors. Things like state benefits from standardizing prices to making sure that people aren't overselling too many time up, overselling to instantly die, et cetera, et cetera. But also you're probably going to mitigate really bad extremes. But fourth, that there is precedence for it. Things like labor markets and laws oftentimes means that you already sell your own time. You already sell like some part of you being able to live your life the way that you want for the like compensation that you get in return. So we would suggest this is actually not much different, and a lot of laws can be adjusted and created following these kinds of blueprints. The last point of framing is that there's also natural limits to this. So as the info slide states, you can buy more time, but it doesn't slow down the natural aging process. So probably even at 90, even if you have an extra 10 years, you are still probably more likely to develop dementia in comparison to you when you were 60. And that is something that is still going to be natural inherent, which is why you're unlikely to have people like immortal rich people. So let's go on to the three arguments I'm going to run. One, why people should be able to do this in principle. Two, why people will make good decisions about this and why that's ultimately good. And finally, why this creates net good, even considering that the people who buy it are likely to be rich. So first, why people should be able to. And I want to frame at the top the four kinds of people who are likely to opt into selling their time. One, it is people who need it immediately, whether it be emergencies because you had a car crash or your mom just got cancer and you have to pay for chemo, et cetera. Second, it is people who need capital to invest in life-changing things. So, for example, you might be like a father who wants to send your kid to school or send your kid to university, and the only way you can do it is to sell your time to have the immediate capacity to change their lives by investing in it. But third, it's people who don't really care about the long life because they value the meaning and the moments that they are able to live in comparison to the amount of moments that they can amalgamate. But fourth, it's people who just don't want to opt into work because they find it more valuable to spend 24/7 reading books, 24/7 debating or what have you, or doom scrolling. And these are all things you think are valid choices people can make. One, this is likely labor market, and if we allow this by law and by design, we should allow this trade in general. We would suggest that the time you spend is oftentimes very similar to the time you spend in the labor market because you are also giving up your time. It's often very mind-numbing and meaningless to you to work a 9-to-5 in a job you don't really want because you want to be able to put food on the table or eventually save up for the trip to Switzerland that you always wanted to do. And so what we would suggest is if that time for you is going to be mind-numbing anyway, your ability to sell the time and not experience it, and oftentimes it is some kind of purgatory and some kind of suffering for you, is something that's equally valid and equally parallel to that of the time you have to spend being forced to work in a capitalist system that needs that money. Second level, time is a tool for people and they always trade it off as they see fit. The choice to go to university, to spend every weekend debating, to choose to sleep 16 hours a day, these all come at the expense of something else. The choice to party every weekend is still a way to shorten your life, but these are all things that people are allowed how to do, because that is a commodity and tool for them to be able to get better experiences, even if life is not longer. But third, on the converse, it's probably equally noble to purchase this, right? Because there's some people who might need to live longer because they are the breadwinners of the family, and they see this as a long-term investment for making sure that their family is more secure. And for example, we would suggest that is something we want people to have the option to do if they want to do it. But like fourth, work is inherently life shortening. You don't know when you'll die, and that is a reality. But what we can do is oftentimes suggest, or like what we can do is at least allow you to choose that you're giving up this in comparison to the suffering that comes with working in the mines, working in factories, being forced to breathe all of these fumes, which all are inherently damaging, shorten your life, but are also far more suffering than that of what we are able to give you. But finally, for some people, living wrong is just torture. Your trauma is collecting. There's the emotional burden of feeling that your family has to pay for your school, but oftentimes you don't know if that's something that you can, like, you really want, or more importantly, you don't know if it's something that is making them give up a lot of things that they want in the first place. All of these things are why people should be able to do it. Let's talk about why people make better decisions. I want to frame at the top that coercive factors will exist in either world, so those decisions are still affected. But one, you can still consult your family, younger people who want to live longer, older people who don't care about the time and learn about living in the moment. These are all ways you can make better decisions. In the same way you consult people about whether or not you should choose X or Y career. Second, you actively make the decision every day. It's a regular choice you practice, as we illustrate in the first argument, which means that it's not something that is much meaningfully different to the choices you have already practiced time and time again. Before the third level, I'll take your POI.
Yeah, if I'm naturally going to die after 6 years and I end up spending, it's like selling 5 years of my time, how will I use the money? Because I probably just have 1 year left and I don't know this because I don't know the date of my death anyway.
That's still 365 days to enjoy your life. The party, to see your friends, to go to Switzerland, if that's all you want. And that is still something we see as inherently valuable. Third level, it's a market that people talk about. It actively affects you in your communities. It becomes a political issue, which means that like media or politics will go both ways and provide you with the information for why you should or shouldn't do it. The impacts here are simple. People live more meaningful lives. There's a psychological effect to being able to give back to your family, even if you can't live longer, or feeling like because you've traded off time, every moment you live counts. It gives you the direct capacity to find life more meaningful, even if it is shorter, because you are not suffering in the interim. But finally, you become happier. In their world, you work 80% of the time and you're tired for 20. In our world, you can be 80, 90, or 100% happy. Finally, for people who will buy it, and we agree it will probably be people who are richer because life is not suffering for them, they have stuff to lose, etc. But people buy time in other ways anyway. The state-of-the-art healthcare called the lifestyles with low risk for them to live longer. The difference in our world is that the benefits go directly to the people who need money instead of pharmaceutical companies who actively benefit off of it anyway.
All right. Thank you so much, Prime Minister. Leader of Opposition to start off from the next slide.
Yeah. Right. I hope I'm audible.
Yep, you are.
Starting in market is going to work. Four things. Firstly, I think it's impossible to find a balance that because as a poor person or as anyone who's going to sell their lives to someone else, it's money that you've gotten from this particular sale to use in your particular life, right? That means that you need time to even go ahead and use the utility of the money that you have gotten, which means that it's impossible for you to find the right kind of balance because you yourself don't know the others. So maybe my projected death age is like after 10 years, right, from 2024. But if I end up selling like 9 years of my life, I really do not know whether how much time I have to even use this money. That means for individuals, it becomes impossible for them to find the right kind of balance of how much time that they have and how much money is going to be used, because if they probably end up selling like 1 year of their life, they have 9 years left, and probably from using sales by selling this 1 year, they just have gotten like some money, right? And that money is probably not going to be enough for them to survive the next 9 years anyway. But if they sell 9 years and they get insane amounts of money, then it becomes impossible for them to use the money. So it's impossible for anyone to find out the right kind of balance, which means in most instances, government's like idea of you being able to live a happy life is going to be massively undercut, considering that you're always going to be thinking, how many years of my life do I have left? And whether this money that I've gotten as a consequence of me selling my life is equivalent or like going to be utilized. Best case scenario is true that people get a get satisfaction of life. I think there's going to be particularly or possible for the people who can't afford to like basic like live decent lives or even middle classes or reach a middle class sense of life are going to like go and sell their lives massively on scale, considering that it's an easy opt-out and they don't have to like fight structures, they don't have to ask governments for welfare schemes. It's like the reason why they're going to sell this things that you sell. You don't have to wait for like things like government schemes to trickle down to you. But secondly, it's certain that you will get this money. What happens in status quo? People tend to go and slog their asses off in most instances, and they are like uncertain whether they even get the fruits of their labor in most instances. That means they're going to go ahead and sell this on a great scale. The reason why I'm just framing this is very simple. When a lot of people are going to sell their lives and sell years of their life, there's going to be a very high supply. And what happens when you have high supply? The prices fall down massively. That's economics 101. So in most instances, you're going to have a very low like return on the invest kind of like money or return on the kind of yields that you're selling, which means that you probably can't unlock a great deal of benefits in most instances, considering the number of poor is just more than the number of rich people who are buying in today's society. So you're going to have a larger number of suppliers, less number of consumers, which means that the prices are going to drop significantly. Thirdly, I think the rich are going to also buy these things hysterically, considering that you want to always be on the safe side of things, right? So if I'm a rich person, I have insane amounts of money, like say a billionaire like Elon Musk, you want to extend your life to as much time as possible. You are not sure right now in today's day and age that you might just die tomorrow or like after 1 year. So you just want to spend as much money as possible, buying as many years as possible to extend the age of life and be on the side of caution and not like, go ahead and die, because you just want, as rich people always want to go ahead and protect things like legacy, but also they also want to have a larger degree of control over the kind of business decisions that they have and see the outcomes of the kind of like investments that they're made in status quo. So these people can afford the idea of saying that my kid also becomes a millionaire, my kid goes to IIT and stuff like that. So those kind of legacy moments and the kind of like ability for you to find happiness in your daily life is just much more if you're a rich person. So you want to continue that happiness, and that's why you're going to go ahead and buy these things on scale, which means that if you go ahead and keep on buying these things, you're going to have a larger number of hoarding of ears by the rich people anyway. But fourthly, I think advances in medical technology right now, like in things like, just increasing the natural cell age of human beings, like what Brian Johnson is currently doing, it just increased massively, considering now the medical industry is going to shift towards going ahead and a prolonging cell age as opposed to solving issues like which are more proximate that improve things right now. So you're not going to put money in things like cancer research, but are you going to go ahead and like research on things on how to naturally ensure that the cell age continues to live on for longer, so you can be like 100 years of age and have the body of like a 40 year old man? That all this kind of research is going to just increase, which means it's going to be a great shift in the way people are going to pursue the medical industry. The reason why this framing is important is because it largely frames out what GovCase is, right? Because GovCase talks about that you can just like go ahead and you can have like benefits that you don't have left, or whether the money is like utile for you in the time that you have left. I think in most instances, people are going to just sell, just use the money in the shortest amount of time possible. So if I end up like selling 5 years of my life, I don't know whether I'm going to die in the sixth year. I just go ahead and spend all the money that I have that I got from this sale and spend it in 1 day or 2 days, because I don't know how much further I'm going to live, right? So you don't want to like space out these things. You'll just go ahead and do this into maximum utility in 1 day as possible. So I don't think the utility and the happiness that you get is going to be extended or prolongated, but rather going to happen in a very short term. I think in the short term, it really becomes very difficult for you to even go ahead and get a lot of utility out of money in the first place. So you can't just like, you can buy a Bugatti, but if you don't have time to drive a Bugatti, the Bugatti is worthless anyway, right? Then, secondly, government says that you can have state-controlled regulations and their markets, and that means that not going just not going to be hysterical selling. I don't think that's true because in state regulations in most developing countries is not as strong. That's why you have a lot of black market where even things like drugs where state regulations exist, but people just find ways to subvert those systems anyway. But lastly, I think I would deal with the idea of the of Gov principle. Gov principle is that time waste happens anyway, and you sell yourself to the labor market anyway. The reason why this particular trade is different from time wasted that happens due to like labor markets or you wasting time scoring deals is that all these kind of investments that you currently make are highly irregular. The reason is simple, that people like come of age on various different occasions. So I might spend 4 years in education, you might spend like 2 years in education. Similarly, I might like some people get old and leave the job market. The reason is that all these investment in these instances is very irregular, and that means it can be managed over time. That's exactly why you don't have like everyone working on minimum wage. Some people do get like higher than minimum wage because it's irregular and how many will opt into the market at every point. But when everyone starts to get the same kind of resource, everyone time, the ability for these prices to drop significantly is massively high. The reason why the harms are going to exist inside government is twofold. One, you're going to have more rich people who just can buy more ears, which means there's a larger exploitation of resources. Because on their side, probably like 1 million rich people die off every year. But on their side, 2 million rich people are going to survive every year, considering that you can go ahead and save your life, right? You can just extend your life. And there's already advancements, so you can probably like, you know, not become a vegetable at the age of 100 or 150. Also, which means a larger exploitation of resources that happens, more environmental damage that happens, larger inequality that happens. These are additional reasons for marginalization of poor in the society. But secondly, the healthcare system shifts like towards prolonging cell life, like I explained, and instead of solving things like cancer and more proximate issues that people face, this directly affects the more poorest of the poor because these people face the things on issues on daily basis. They don't care about prolonging health, right? They care about like saving themselves from basic diseases like malaria. You don't research on those things on their side of the house, and that's a net harm for all those.
All right. DPM to continue from top side.
Hello, am I audible, visible?
Yes, sir, both.
Starting in 3, 2, 1. Two call outs and then three contributions on BPM. First call out. They say black markets will exist on our either side of the house or our side of the house, especially because, for example, this technology exists, so people will engage with it, etc., absent the market. I want to note that they don't explain why this technology and the ability to facilitate this large-scale market can exist outside of the state. Okay. But I just want to note, it's far less likely that people opt into it in the first place if they don't think it's facilitated and backed by the state, insofar as it's literally dealing in like life years, for example. So I'm not sure what the harm is or the impact of the harm is. Secondly, they agree from this previous speaker that this is a market that is regulated, it is a market that exists within the society. They have to concede that certain things like labor regulations also have to apply. So things like, for example, price floors, the ability to set, for example, the amount of supply within that particular market, etc., the ability for people to not be coerced into these particular things, such as, for example, you kind of financially coerce someone to sell all of their life years and just immediately die, also exists in either world, which means that they have to concede that by them literally not challenging it when they had the opportunity to do so from leader of opposition. To that extent, then I'll offer three contributions. First contribution, I will just absolutely win the characterization battle, even though it was literally not responded to from the previous speaker about why people will make rationality or have rationality when they make this choice. I will concretely, definitively prove it. Secondly, I'll talk about society. And thirdly, I'll talk about even if rich people get better, that's like, okay. Firstly, then, let's win the characterization battle on rationality. They say a couple of things on why people will be irrational. They say, one, you have an immediate benefit to things such as your lived experiences. You can have more money, you will buy all of these things, etc. But secondly, you don't have the ability to weigh these impacts in your own life. Note that this literally are all counter assertions and not responses to all of the things we already preempt in response to this. Firstly, if they say it is immediate benefits, it is good because you are able to make choices when you immediately need it. Because we say from our from previous speaker from our previous speaker that people will make this choice when it is most proximate to them, when it is most necessary to them, because they weigh other social factors that would make them not want to make this choice. Like them living like normal life years because they've been normalized and socialized to live normal life years with other people. But if there's a degree of harm that happens in their own lives, that is to say poverty, that is to say they feel so much guilt because they cannot send their children to college or all of these things that benefit them like healthcare, they would make this rational choice and it is an immediate thing so they don't suffer in it. On their side of the house, they will still have to provide for these things. But here's the kicker. They kill themselves by saying it's immediate because their side spends 20 years solving the problem and 20 years of unhappiness, 20 years of toiling at a backbreaking job, etc. without the ever guarantee that your wages track with inflation. Your wages, for example, are guaranteed. So I am not sure why all of this is worth the trade-off on their side and they kill themselves with the urgency impact. But secondly, they say people don't weigh this well. I want to know, there's a lot of information within this market, not only because this is such an important thing that happens, a lot of people engage with it, but also your family and friends talk to you about it, so you'll make this rational choice anyways. Even if people make this irrationally, they don't respond to the previous speaker why this is simply not something we afford to individuals. We support them within the state. Their state controls every aspect of your life. It gives you, for example, lots of like police, has a lot of police power to put you in prison, etc. Often at the cost of your own life, a lot of your life years. You have the ability that, and you should be given that right, every citizen, to trade off some of those years for benefits within that state insofar as you need to protect yourself and to protect your family. I am not sure why they defeat that principle. So again, people will make this rationally. Even if they don't, it's something that should afford it to these individuals. Secondly then, let's talk about society in the true comparative. They do not respond to the mechanisms that we give. That's why specifically this is so beneficial for a lot of people. One, if it's they say rich people will just engage in the market a lot, that is good because rich people on their side of the house will still want to lengthen their lives, for example, and going to pharmaceutical companies and getting life extending payments. But this funnels into pharmaceutical companies. This funnels into very, very rich private companies, etc. And often doesn't funnel to the average person. On our side of the house, we progressively tax them when they engage in the market, which means they have lots of capital to be gained from this, and they're likely to have the incentive to engage in the market anyways. This money is likely to be used for things such as poor people, for example, demanding that the government should not have the need in the first place for the system, like more welfare for them so they don't even have to opt into it in the first place because they also agree that it's going to be something talked about on the ground. People will be against it in some way. So, for example, have political capital for increasing in welfare and the government has money to do so because they tax the rich increasingly. What this does is maybe trade some inequality. They used to say, maybe there's some time inequality versus income inequality or economic inequality because the state has, you know, the ability to resources to fund individuals. But that is so much better because I am not sure what 10 more years for a billionaire having private jets and just going around the country or the world is harmful to me as a poor person versus me literally getting more welfare and having the opportunities to uplift my family from poverty. So again, society is more likely to have better choices, even if rich people opt into it. They don't fail, and they fail to prove their comparative with why it's good on their side of the house. Before I go on specifically on why rich people as an extension, even if they engage in it, is still good, I'll take it through, yeah.
Yeah, if the end goal of your case is to tax the people on the sale and then use this money to go and enforce welfare so that people don't opt into this policy, then what are you debating? You can just have more people on our side without put critical pressure on the state to do it anyway.
I mean, like nuance, right? So people will engage in it when they need, for example, the need for it. But generally speaking, we would all want a life where we don't have to trade off our literal life years. So again, there will still be an incentive to want things such as social welfare. So this doesn't exist. What you have is a government that has that money because you get progressively taxation from people that would not have had this money distributed to the economy otherwise. That is a very simple mechanism. I am not sure why you're not able to track it. Thirdly, then on rich people and why specifically rich people, even if they engage in it, is still okay. Number one, and you know, to prove why these rich people aren't citizens within that economy, like often many people who are rich, for example, are subject to the same pressures to live the rest of your life in constant grind, etc. The problem is that these people literally don't have the time to spend with their families, even if they're rich at the end, because they literally die. So again, they don't prove why these principally aren't people that we care about within this debate. But secondly, I want to know there's so many harms if rich people don't, for example, have the time to have succession like sorted out within their businesses, etc. Or often they gain lots of economic benefits for people when they're able to, for example, consolidate some of their wealth at the end of their life, etc. because they have a little bit more extra years. But thirdly, this isn't just a concession for why rich people will live forever. There are natural reasons for them to eventually stop. Like, for example, many of their loved ones will die into the future if they aren't as rich as them. For example, they will get bored of life and they will have natural aging in their brains, which makes them harder to enjoy life. What this means is probably like 40 years at max, 50 years at max, or however many for rich people to engage with on their side of the house, likely is the case. But on our side of the house, it is poor people getting guaranteed benefits that they can spend right now to uplift their lives. These people want this choice. They need this choice and are granted this choice by our state. On their side of the house, they are simply robbed of agency. For those reasons, then, to folks.
All right. Thank you so much, DLO.
10 seconds.
Sure, sure.
Am I audible? Two, one. First, I want to break their claim on choice. First, different people have different idea of how valuable their life is, and that is something they concede in PM. At a point of time, for someone, it can be valuable, or for someone, it could be invaluable. Therefore, any type of standardization that happens is still going to take away their choice, because you're still putting or forcing them to sell their life for probably $500, and there's still going to be intense backlash for any standardization that happens in this market. But second, this market is going to be so huge, and it's going to be basically more actualizing or more intensely for most poor people who probably live in unregulated area where information channels are very less. So it is less like, if the government ever proves any model as to why standardization of this would even work in cases where probably people live in areas which are much more secluded from urban areas, etc., where most government control exists. But second, I think people do not have any incentive or any impetus to ask state or to push state to create change, because they can get an opt-out, which government again concedes from getting that food instead of going ahead and protesting against that government and asking for a long-term change. So any impetus to push state is also something that literally becomes negligible on their side of the house, because there is an opt-out present. But second, there is no impetus for state also to change, because they can just nudge you into selling, right? They can tell you that there are other mechanisms for you to get only years of life instead of protesting, etc., and diminish your choice of getting any sort of welfare. I think the third, older people and people who are probably ill and vulnerable can be forced by family to alleviate financial burden. This further takes away their choice from the most valuable thing that defines their existence. So it looks like that older people being forced by their daughters and sons to sell their 5 years of life or sell their 10 years of life by justifying that whatever your life is left is something that does not have utility, while we as youngsters have more utility. And someone who earns more for the family, and therefore we need to live long to do this, to earn more money or support their families. So again, choice is harm for the most vulnerable people who do not even want to sell their lives but are forced to do so. But fourthly, this actualizes intensely for those who are poor, who value now money over life, because now in our side of the house, they probably do not have a capacity to sell their life for money, but on their side of the house, when they have capacity to do so, they're going to do it in the worst ways, because money is something that is tangible that they can realize, but also show people that they need to find an opt-out. At a point of time, there is a simple opt-out outside government. They are forced to sell their life years, even if they don't want to, because there is no other choice possible, but also state is pushing them to do so. This leads to a race to bottom, because now the need of money is so intense that someone is selling 6 years of their life for $1,000, and while the other is selling his 6 years of life for $500. That is how standardization is then further harmed at side government. Have acute need of getting money, and there is a huge plan is something that exists largely in very intense manners aside government, causing it to be a race to bottom. The problem with this is then that people sell their lives for money that they probably cannot justify their life for. And at a point of time, no one knows what their value of life is, and it is so subjective. Their choice is something that is harmed outside government. But the last thing is that immediate benefit can't weigh this, what government wants to run, because there is intense lack of information to people that even if you can enjoy that immediate benefit or not, you don't know how long you're going to live. So if BPM wants to say that, oh, you are going to be harmed for 20 years versus an immediate benefit, that weighing does not work, because first, you do not know whether that immediate benefit would actually benefit you or not, or whether you would be able to enjoy it or not, or whether you have that amount of life in your period left or not. But against a 20 years of fighting and getting some welfare change is still better than that, because at least it works for the future generation universally. You can enjoy their whole lives, but enjoy their time, it still would be limited and restricted. I think then for future generation who are larger and still have much more time to live, I think that becomes true. Because of the difference is that you losing this life on our side of the house does not result in someone else gaining that life. And that is something that exclusively happens outside government. Therefore, losing lives in capitalistic structures is something that is universal to everyone on our side of the house. Therefore, it does not exaggerate a poor-rich divide, which only happens outside government. But second, oftentimes, even if you spend time in capitalist areas, you do it anyways outside government too. They just assert that when you get that money, you go to Switzerland. They never prove why I just leave my corporate job once I sell some years of my life. Because note, the need of more money is something that always remains on both sides of the house. If I sell my life for $5,000, I still want $10,000 to get a much better life for my family. So not only you lose years of your life outside government, the capacity of you to enjoy that money is also something that is largely restricted, because capitalistic structures, patriarchal structures, sexist structures, racist structures still exist inside government. So they will never prove why people had the capacity to enjoy life at any point of time. On our side of the house, when you could have spent that last amount of your life in retirement chilling, you still keep working under capitalist structures inside government at every point of time. But lastly, even if you sell life working in corporate, I think there are still instances of you laughing with your friends, caring for your child, the time you love and care about. At a point of time as a breadwinner to earn more money, and at a point of time you don't know how much life is left, you become more and more paranoid, because now you have lesser and lesser time to earn more and more money. At a point of time that is true, you now force yourself to overwork more. You now give more validation to things like corporate structures instead of your family and etc. Yes, Pia.
So why is it any better to live the rest of your life, the next 40 to 50 years, corporate slaving? And
the problem is that change happens on our side of the house. Even if in status quo people live 40 or 50 years of life working in capitalistic structures, they do so that on your side of the house. But the difference is that after 100 years, change is something that can only happen on our side of the house, because we push state to change. We push for social justice movements to happen, because there are more poor people asking for change. I think that is something that only happens on our side of the house. So lastly, why immortal people or immortal rich people is something that is likely outside government. First, in presence of this market, rich people are highly incentivized to further put money in cell research and diseases like dementia and Alzheimer's, because literally research is being done in status quo on this. Silicon Valley is going mad about immortality. This pushes away money from more important healthcare issues like increasing access or creating free healthcare. So this invention is something that only keeps restricted to top people who are likely to live now 150 or 200 years. But second, precedence of medical technology proves it, how far we have come in such a short time. So money is shifted to such technologies more and more. Therefore, in long term, it is likely that rich people don't develop such diseases and live life immortally. The last thing I then want to do is why rich people at top is something that is bad. First, they utilize the most amount of resources. Their carbon footprint is 100 times more than a poor person. So living more means utilizing resources for a longer amount of time. So double the amount of resources being used. This is bad, because now you hurt the climate more. Resource depletion increases more. Therefore, future generation people now have a lesser, better world to live in. But second, you often create hegemonies on top. New leaders cannot come into picture, and authoritarian leaders remain on top, therefore hurting people on ground more. Because of these reasons,
thank you so much. Go friend.
Hi, am I audible? Is this okay?
Yep, I'm audible and visible both.
So much. I'll take. Pick it up now. Okay. Sorry, someone just dropped something in the room. I think you guys to the chat, please. Allowing people to determine and consent to the monetary value of life gives them control, because it is an escape from menial and laborious minimum wage jobs that they otherwise would have done, that they now get to spend more meaningful time with their kids before they get too old, where, for example, they cannot provide or just play around in the park with their loved ones. The more important thing is that time is being stripped away from people currently. Our policy returns agency that the labor market has stolen from them. At the top of my speech, I want to deal with this claim on extremely low prices. First is, we have fiat. This is a this household's motion. So if we say that there's likely to be a floor, there probably will be a floor. But if they want to prove it on likelihood, then people would only consent to this market if they think that the money that they would have gotten is better than if they just worked in the first place. So at the very least, there will be some pressure to conform to the minimum wage in order to, for example, measure the value of that time. But also, realistically, people will not just sell 50 years of their life for the same reasons that they give. That people are very, very uncertain. That people, for example, do not know what they might want in the future. So even if they sell a lot of years, it's more likely to be an incremental decision they make every now and then. So for example, every 2 years, they adjudicate, should I sell more years of my life for this particular amount of money, so and so forth. So a lot of the informed decisions still happen. But more importantly, our case works even if you do not believe that we have sufficient prices, for the reason that our principal justification, which is, by the way, unresponded to by a lot of the speakers thus far, still stands. Before I go on with the two issues, I want to deal with this clash on long-term solutions. Let's first talk about environmental solutions. First is, activists are typically middle-class Gen Z individuals. I'm unsure as to why, if you, the poor individuals who probably rely on the like economy the most to, for example, distribute single-use plastics, would be the ones to fight for the environment anyways. But secondly, the rich are typically the ones who invest in green tech, etc., which drive the race for climate tech. The important thing is they will have more incentive to do it under our side. Here's a flip. Because they live longer. That is, they will live through the worst harms of climate change. Disasters that destroy resource reserves that their companies are built on. Pollution that affects them and their children if we assume that climate gets really, really bad. So therefore, they actually have the direct incentive furthermore to invest in it now, because oftentimes the excuse of rich individuals is they will not live when, for example, the world is burning. On the other side, they will choose to live there, and that's how they will solve it. Secondly, is another thing on medicine. The first thing I want to characterize is that the trickle-down mechanism that they say and the benefit pass is not true. Poor people cannot access medicine currently in status quo because either it is too expensive or, for example, overcrowded public hospitals, when even the most advanced public system in the UK, which the NHS, often has 2 years of a queue, which the average poor person cannot wait for. But there's also an active trade-off from work. So, for example, if you go to the hospital, you can't go to work, etc., which a lot of people wouldn't consent to anyways. So therefore, a lot of the benefits of the good medical system that they say are inaccessible on both sides. But more importantly, even if you assume this is true, there's still sufficient demand that exists under our side. Why? One, people are still sick, like the middle class and, for example, the rich, who, by the way, are typically the people that vote in elections anyways and tip the scales. So there's still be like, it's likely to be a political hot voter issue regardless. But secondly, the rich want to mitigate the effects of natural aging. If we assume they want to live 200 years, at 90, they'll probably get dementia. So you know that means they'll develop medicine to cure dementia at all, or for example, mitigate its effects so they can benefit from the amount of years that they bought. So therefore, there still is development in health. But lastly, on unions, one, the stigmatic proof by unions would work. I think it's unsure they would work. But secondly, some people would still work because not everyone would enter this market, like people who already have capital anyways. So I'm unsure why unions would cease to exist. The first thing I want to deal with is on the principle justification. When does the state legalize something? The principle response, or the closest principle response we hear, is that the poor will sell on scale, which is bad. One, they have to overcome a lot of the reasons we give, like you want to consult with your family, etc., which often means that even if you are starving or even if you are desperate, it's not like you give 50 years off the bat. But secondly, this is just a non-issue because of the framing of how we posited the problem in status quo, which is that the poor already sell like tens of years of their lives to work that harms them, that exposes them to environmental destruction, that makes it that they're unable to spend time with their family, and when they go home, they're often too tired or too depressed to do anything meaningful or happy with their lives. So in fact, if it's the problem that the poor, for example, is harm to the poor, we tell you there's already a problem, there's already a harm that the poor actively suffer through, and we actually fix that. But secondly, even if you don't believe that, there are other margins to which you win the debate on this issue. That one, it's the immediate benefit. And I actually want to use their analysis here. They say it is unsure if you can get the fruits of labor, which is why you'd want to opt into this market because it's certain. That's a good thing, because if their problem is that people cannot spend money meaningfully under our side, then presumably people do not know when they die, or they have no way to approximate their life for the reason that they can't, for example, determine that their life is 10 years shorter than a lot of the problems that they say exist. Then they come up with this really ridiculous problem at the DLO. Like, what if I want 10,000 instead of 5,000 years? That is perfectly fine. You can work. The point is that people, is instead of spending 50 years of your life in work, you only have to spend 25 or 20. And the other time that you could have had that you would have been constantly stressed, you could have spent with your family, etc. If at all, just, or in the absolute best case, you just don't work anyways and you can do all the fulfilling things we want. So for all, and lastly, on the other harms that could happen, like the poor individuals are exposed to things like, for example, a lot more risk. They don't have insurance by companies because companies don't want to shell it out. At least on their R side, they just do not, are they're not exposed to those risks in the first place, which probably means they can spend their time better because they aren't bedridden or something. I'd like PY.
You can prove that selling 5 years of life actually compensates for 5 years of work, and we show that prices of the this life is actually quite low. So you still have to work. That's still a harm.
Yeah, yeah. But the point is that instead of working 50 years on a demeaning job, you only have to work 20 or you don't have to work 25. And the other years you could have spent with your family. Or in the absolute worst case, your sister is sick and you want to pay for a medical bill. At least now you have the ability to pay for a medical bill, as opposed to another side where a corporation probably would not want to give you advance on your work. On the second issue, where do people live better and more meaningful lives? I want to answer two questions here. Firstly, Ajay, Jenny, what makes life meaningful? And there are three things here. The first is on the control over time. The reason why regret is a terrible thing and is considered never-ending torture is because it's time wasted that you cannot get back because you spent time on work instead of doing things that made you happy, etc. It is also the same reason why the state doesn't force people to conform to one work schedule, because people should have ability to control how much time that they have, which is in line with our principle. But secondly, it is about pursuing what makes you happy. The problem for people is the moment that they are done from work, it is too late to pursue happiness. They are already sick. They are already too mentally exhausted to experience life and find meaning from it. Opposition says that people will spend money poorly because they don't know how much time they have left. But firstly, you just have immediate costs you could spend on, like education or medical emergencies or insurance for your family. But even then, even if you cannot determine, you just have good things that you could spend money on, like protecting your family or makes you happy. They say the trip to Switzerland is something that you wouldn't value. The point is that people can determine what they value now because they have the money to express that preference of what they value. But lastly, on the complete burden, at least on our side, you have financial compensation that is sure that you can at least enjoy when you are in your prime in your life, as opposed to something that you might not even benefit from on opposition. For those reasons, propose.
All right. Thank you so much, Govind. Whip, opposition whip.
Starting in a couple of seconds. Am I clearly visible as well as audible?
Yes, for both.
Perfect. Once going off web, I'll try to take a POI. Just don't unmute yourselves. Starting my speech in three. Just a second. Yeah. Starting my speech in 3, 2, 1. I first want to deal with the idea on choice, and I want to show you how this is not going to be a rational choice. Secondly, on work and how it's actually not a harm and quite uncomparative. Lastly, I'm going to tell you how to actually judge, on what metrics to actually judge this debate. Firstly, on why this can't be a rational choice. In order to make a rational choice, you need to have information. We told you that the scope of information in this scenario is quite limited because you don't know the amount of time that you're going to live, and therefore you also don't know the amount of time you're going to have to spend that money in the first place. It means, like as Angad said, you might have 6 years to live and you spend 5 years of that, so you just don't have time to spend all the money that you just earned. But secondly, we also show you that the price of this life is going to go down and down because we showed you how rich, how poor people are coerced into selling this, which is why the amount of money that you get in return is actually not that good, or like not that much, so you can actually rationalize into the amount of time that you spend, because you're always going to think that, hey, I got X amount of money, but I spent 5 years, but I sold 5 years of my life, maybe I could have gotten more. That's something that you're always going to feel on their side of the house, which is why this choice can't be rational. But second, they posit again and again that you trade time when you go to work, and that work, going to work, is a harm. They never prove why going to work is a harm. They only assert it. I'm going to give you a couple of reasons as to why people are actually working on both sides, and the delta on work is actually quite small. And even if the marginal delta on our side is you work more, it's still good. Firstly, I would posit the reason why people still work on their side because they never feel that the money that they get is enough. That is, they themselves say that people are in dire need of money. That's why they trade their time. And DPM concedes that people actually don't want to do this. They just have to do this because they want the money exchange of time, which means people like the taste of having money, which is why they always want to maximize the amount of money that they can get. But you can't keep selling years of your life or you'll die. So you probably spend 5 years, you sell 5 years of your life, but you're also still likely to go to work because you always want to have more and more because the world is capitalistic, as they can see it. You want to maximize the amount of money that you want to have. Second, I would posit that once you get this money, the quality of life increase is actually quite small. Why? Because inflation happens, because every poor person is selling this, which means every poor person gets to make a lot of money, which means the price of the goods in the market goes up because everyone has more money now, which is why the net increase in quality of life is actually quite small. Third, I would posit that when you go to work, it's actually good. Why? Because you get to form memories, you get to meet people, you get to work with them, you get to take lunch breaks with them, you bond with them, make jokes about your boss, you take cigarette breaks, etc. That is something that you can vent about, you can talk to your workers about your boss, and so that's something that helps you deal with. And when you come back home, you get to tell stories about how your work day went, etc. Fourth, I would posit that going to work also saves you from boredom. That is, when you're just at home 24/7, you have nothing to do fucking, and that's something that incredibly bores you because you have to stay with the same people again. There's literally no change of scenery. You're surrounded by your three people of your family member all the time. I would say that the reason that people actually like going to work is that it's actually a change of scenery from their home. A lot of people live in toxic home or live in toxic homes where they have to get a change of scene in order to get out of the room that they fought with their wife in and have to actually vent with their friends at work so they can have a drink or something and then come back. So they come back with a fresh mind and something, and things are not as toxic at home at that point, which instance is actually good for people to go to work. But also boredom is bad because going on a trip to Switzerland or something, and we're talking about poor people, so obviously don't go to Switzerland, but like going to Agra or something to see Taj Mahal or something is only valuable insofar as it is spaced out, insofar as it is rare, insofar you only have to take a vacation once a year. It's not valuable if you take a vacation every single fucking week, which is why it's good that even if you like take lesser breaks or go on lesser vacations because you have lesser time to spend, I would posit the amount of value that you derive out of the time is still huge. Fifth, money runs out. That is, once you sell 5 years of your life, that's a one-time amount that you get. But note, inflation still exists. The prices of stuff still goes up by 8% every year, at least in India it does, which would mean that if you worked for 5 years, the amount of salary that you would have gotten also would have kept increasing due to inflation. But the money that you get from 5 years is one time. So the value of this money actually keeps going down. But the value of money that you get from work actually keeps going up because it's symmetric, or like it's in sync with inflation, which is why the money that you get on their side is actually not enough and you still have to work. Due to this, this is why people still like make investments. People who are lower middle class and middle class also make investments in stocks and stock market, etc. But they still go to work. Why? Because they know that that's not something that's reliable, because something that's extremely stationary, extremely small, and they still need to work in order to get money. All of this analysis proves two things. First, going to work is symmetric on both sides. And even if it's not, even if we go to work a bit more on our side, it's still not a harm. I say that it's actually good. And also lastly, just one last reason is that when you spend 5 years of your life on their side, you actually don't get to live through those 5 years. So you feel as if you lost a lot of the autonomy and choices that you could have made in those 5 years. You lost the right to live those 5 years of your life. On our side, you actually get to live those 5 years and you feel more autonomous, which is why it's actually good that you go to work, because you at least get to make some autonomous decisions, as I said. Therefore, you don't judge this debate on, hey, where do you go to work, because it's actually good and actually quite uncomparative. There are three things how you judge. First is on the length of life that you actually have to assert your autonomy, because you show on our side that you still make money through your job, which keeps increasing your time due to inflation and all those things, which is why on ours the delta then becomes that on our side, since you live longer 5 years, you have more time to spend that money and to enjoy your life actually. Secondly is on the likelihood of change. We tell you multiple reasons as to why change and structural change and welfare is more likely on our side, because on our side people actually have an impetus to change, and state actually have an impetus to change too, because state can't just offset by saying, hey, send your years of life or whatever, and you can still make money. You can't offset this burden, and people also don't have, like, people also have more motivation on our side. Second is, old leaders die, like old rich leaders actually don't live that long, and we show that they live that long for hundreds of years, and they spend a lot of money trying to make this life good and worthwhile living, which means that on their side, older and conservative leaders live more longer, which means they take longer to die, which means new leaders who are probably more liberal, who can probably bring about change, also take more time to come up. But third is, But yeah, so all of our third is that insofar as those people live longer and these rich people have more years of life, they can also form more years of hegemony, or like more have their hegemony for a greater amount of time on the country's political system, which is why change on their side is quite unlikely. So on a comparative, change on our side is more likely, which is why the quality of life becomes better on us. And not only is a longer life, but the quality of life is also better. Lastly, is on resource concentration. If rich people live 100 of years, they're probably also going to consume exorbitantly more resources, because a rich person obviously consumes more than a poor person because they have more needs, hedonistic treatment, etc. But they also have like 100 times greater carbon footprint. And rich doesn't face the harm of environment of climate change, as Gavip says. No, they can live in ACs, they can buy air purifiers, etc. They can easily prevent themselves from facing the harm of climate change. The harms of climate change is faced by people who are poor, who are extremely vulnerable to all of this, which is why on their side, the short amount of life you have is full of more suffering, because there's more climate change, because there's more rapid increase in the global temperature, and there's like more erratic weather conditions on their side of the house. It's not just a harm onto people who are at the bottom, who get lesser resources because rich eat more resources, but also harm onto future generations who are going to come up, because they're going to face the harms of environmental change much more severely than current generations. Extremely proud to oppose.
Thank you so much. Opposition reply. Start with the replies.
Hi, so there's just a change. I'll be giving a reply instead of Bishop.
Okay, so that's Angad going as reply. Cool.
Yeah. All right. Starting in 3, 2, 1. I just want to point out strategic flaws inside government's case. Like, I think that will be enough to win this debate and reply. Firstly, on principle, I think the principle is largely inconsistent, because they don't prove why this is overarchingly true in most instances, considering that we explain that firstly, this principle is not true for the same kind of for this particular market, insofar as that no one else gains your time when you're wasting time on like social media watching reels, or you're just wasting time doing corporate jobs. You get a direct benefit from this, and no one else gains this particular time. Whereas when you have this market, someone else is going to directly gain your time and going to cut down from your time. So you don't get a return, but rather you end up on the negative side of things when you're going giving away your time. But secondly, we also told you that the time investment that currently happens in things like labor markets and on watching Instagram reels is highly irregular. Not everyone is watching reels at the same time. Not everyone is getting an education at the same time. Some people are already doing a job. Some people are doing an education. There's a huge difference in the kind of people who opt into the market at all instances. That's why you have sanitization of the market, because it keeps on like correcting itself after every few years. The problem with this particular market of you giving away your life is that it's going to be highly irregular, considering everyone's going to sell their lives as soon as they get this option, considering it's an easy opt-out of suffering. They don't explain why people are not likely to go ahead and opt into this by short-circuiting all decision-making processes. They will not go and create impetus on government to go and bring structural changes. They just go ahead and give this life away right now, because it gives an immediate monetary benefit, because it needs to actualize. This is literally the best case scenario. So if the best case scenario is true, I don't think the principle can stand, because then in most instances it's going to be highly irregular, and that means the time-wasted argument is just uncomparative at best. Secondly, on choice, we explained that this choice is going to be coerced in most instances, considering that there's going to be impetus. There's not going to be any impetus from you to go ahead and bring about structural change, but state is going to rather nudge you to opt into alternate sources of recourse as opposed to bringing structural change in society. That means you don't want welfare schemes, you rather just go ahead and, you know, just give up your ear so that you can get a better life. So it's going to be coerced by individuals, not just by state, but also family members who put pressure on older people to go ahead and alleviate financial burden. That's why it's going to be coerced in most instances. But even if there is an incentive to make a rational free choice, the structural reason why you can't make a free choice is that you don't have information. So I don't know when I'm actually going to die biologically. So how will I exactly know how much time is okay for me to give away? Because the money that I get from selling this particular life has to be proportional. I need time also to spend this money. I really don't know why like living 2 days is okay. And if I'm a billionaire for 2 days, how is that a good net good? I literally have no clue. That means if you can't ever find a balance, if you don't have information, you don't have the capacity to make a rational choice, even if you have incentives to go ahead and do that. We'll also posit that this lack of knowledge also creates a massive paranoia inside your head, because there's always uncertainty of when you're actually going to die, or whether you gave away enough years, or did you give away like less years, right? That particular uncertainty also reduces the amount of utility derived from the money that you even get in the best case scenario. But also, even if you're not paranoid, and this is us being extremely charitable, even if you're not paranoid, the prices of this particular life is going to go down massively, because the number of poor people, the number of sellers is just sheerly more the number of buyers. So you will have lesser prices you get for life. So on scale itself, the amount of money, utility you derive from the money is going to be extremely less. And you don't know then why this particular money gives you the most amount of benefits anyway. If the same image needs to be fulfilled, I think the trade-off is never justified with your immediate needs being fulfilled rather than like a larger scope of like our case that talks about how movements will have no impetus to work and bring about structural change like welfare schemes asking for rights. Because there's going to be no one who's going to ask for these things, right? People will just sell off their lives and like just end their lives because it's easier for them to do. Everyone will opt for utilitarian principle and not fight the longer war. The wars that are required for against state to go ahead and bring trickle down, bring social equity. Those things never happen. If DPM concedes that you need pressure on governments, but the idea is that you can sell your life. I really don't know who's going to be there to pressurize the governments, considering that you're on an easy way out. They never explain why people are not going to resort to this as a first line of attack, first line of defense, as opposed to like a rational thought process. Everyone is going to go ahead and just get as much amount of money as possible. If that happens, there's going to be no pressure on state to ever make any sort of changes. That means structural changes never happen on their side. That means the people who are making rational choice of staying alive just keep on suffering even much more worse, because the rich never die and the poor people are not protesting. For all those,
thank you so much for the very last speech. Government reply.
Hi, am I audible and visible?
Yes, for both.
Okay. There are 168 hours in a week. In that week, you spend 40 to 60 hours working, if you're lucky. You spend another 60 hours on sleep, another 30 hours getting ready for work and commuting, and what is left for you is less than 40 hours a week to yourself. And in that 40 hours, you have to balance things like caring for your family, attending your daughter's recitals, catching up on work or stressing about it like internally, going to the doctor because you're sick, and doing anything else you have to do for the household. And what is left for you, therefore, is virtually nothing. You are a shell of a person who is just a cog in a capitalist machine. The extreme nihilism of wanting to end your life is something we think is probably, I think, one, unlikely, but two, honestly, far worse in their side, where there's no life really worth living. It is on our world that you at least get something in return. It's on our world that maybe you might only have a couple more weeks to live, but in that couple more weeks, you have so much more time with your family than you would have had if you worked an entire month while trying to be stressed, while trying to be happy with your daughter, but you're stressing deep inside because of work and your boss shouting at you, what have you. That is the unfortunate reality that they want you to live by. What we want to give you is the choice to do something different. First, I want to talk about structures and change. And I want to note that all the bad things they say that you're going to be subject to are things that would exist in either world. The fine print and contracts that you don't have legal literacy to be able to deal with or negotiate, things like inflation, are all things that, mind you, they never really explain will not exist on their world, or will be at least not as bad on their world. And second, they never explain that these are outcomes of having this market. So we have to assume they're just saying that people are suffering and that is that. That is precisely the point. They say that people deal with inflation, but in the same breath say that you will get $1 million and die tomorrow because you sold the next 10 years. And we can say then maybe that just means that they solve their own issue. By design of their case, there's no real problem. Because if you die before you feel any of the effects, that is still a happy life for you. But second, we will say it ignores other cultural factors that would make you want to live. The fact that you still care about your family, the fact that you would have people like bedwetters who might still want to live a bit longer because they see that as a long-term investment if they care about it. These are life-changing things to people that we are able to provide them. Their world is poor people will suffer for 10 to 20 years, and we hope they will be emboldened enough to be angry to fight for change. Our world benefits these people in a world in which they opt out of work to do this. And by opting out of work, we force governments to be better or corporations to be better because they ultimately still need labor to be able to function. And therefore, it's just better on net for people because they can choose both and they're going to compete with each other. Let's talk about meaning and why we therefore win on it. Their main criticism of this market is, what if you buy a Bugatti and die tomorrow? My question is, why is that a harm? Because really, it's not. Death to the individual is amoral. Some might perceive it as a loss, and others might perceive it as relief. as freedom. What matters is that people who engage in this trade show an express preference of quality over length of time. And that is who this motion affects. So maybe you have only 24 hours to live, but one, you chose to do that. What matters is in those final moments, you are happy. Maybe you don't get to enjoy your money, but that's money that can still empower their families, which in and of itself is still meaningful, which in and of itself are oftentimes what people still strive for. What this ultimately means is, if the values of the world don't radically change in either world, it is on our world where that meaning is something that people can access more immediately. Second on choice then, they say, you know, you don't get the consent to, or you don't know when you die, so it's not a meaningful choice. But you don't know a lot of things. You don't know when you're going to have a career life injury. You don't know if you're going to get a heart attack from get cardiac arrest because you're so stressed and you're on Red Bull. Corporations want you to work, and you can cut down on work hours by taking your time, by selling it, by seeing that you want to be able to exercise that freedom of choice to find happiness. If both sides are equally coercive, then at least you can choose the kind of coercion that you're subject to, and that is more choice than what you give. That you get on their side. Why is meaning the most important issue in this debate? It is just the core of all outcomes that both sides want to prove. We want to prove that people will be happier. We want to prove that they will not be subject to abuses. And by design of that choice, that is what we are able to provide you. Because maybe Op wants you to access better healthcare. We want you to feel happy. It is in that meaning, even if it's not for an extended period of time, that you can ultimately evaluate life as meaningful and like net good.
Thank you so much, everyone, for your speeches. With that, we come to the end of the debate. OC, you can stop the recording now.
Thanks for the debate.
Also, in the meantime, because it's a multiple judge panel, can the speakers